This is Out of the Box with your host, Jonathan Clark. Out of the Box, Sunday nights at 9 on Q104.3.
All right, welcome back. Jonathan Clark, we're in the studio with a guy who is in the current version of Yes, featuring John Anderson and Trevor Rabin. He's a member of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He has sold millions of albums. He is also on the Grumpy Old Rockstar Tour, which is an evening with him of music and laughter with songs from Yes, David Bowie, The Beatles, and more. Playing the Paramount Theater in Huntington September 24th, Bergen Pack October 10th. All the tour dates, rwcc.com. And the new album is Christmas Portraits. It's the fabulous Rick Wakeman. An honor to have you in the studio, sir.
Oh, the check cleared that I gave you. That's very kind. Nice introduction, so thank you.
As he references payola from the 70s.
Absolutely.
Which I had nothing to do with.
No, anyway. Those were the days when you went around any jock's house and it was full of new fridges and cookers and
televisions.
That's it. You got it.
Oh, my God. Unbelievable. Well, let me first start with your speech at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Right.
I did watch it on YouTube. It's probably been viewed millions of times as we speak, but it might be the best acceptance speech I have ever heard in my life. Did you write that out, or is it what stream of conscious humor?
Basically, in the UK, I'm known for comedy as much as I am for music. I hosted a big comedy show in the UK for 8 years called Live at Jonglers, and there was a huge program called Grumpy Old Men in England, which ran for 6 years. Massively popular program. I was on all of those.
Yeah.
So I got known a lot for humor and doing stand-up. I've done stand-up tours and things around that in England. And it was interesting because I have this thing. I was extremely proud that Yes got inducted into the Hall of Fame. I wish the band had got in earlier, because hopefully then Chris would have been alive and he would have got to enjoy it. That was my only sadness about it, but very proud to get in. But I have this thing about award ceremonies, and it's nothing to do with the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. It goes to the BAFTAs in England, or the Golden Globes, or the Oscars. It's called acceptance speeches. I mean, they're just dreadful. I mean, how many times do you want to hear somebody thank their mother, their dad, their uncle, the director, the producer, the woman who did the makeup, the aunt who bought the guitar and the first guitar strings? Yeah, nobody is remotely interested. And you can tell that because when people are talking, it's not that people don't care. They're just not listening. They're talking around the tables.
Right,
and
exactly,
so you can hear this huge hum of talking. And they've got to get it over with because we want to hear the band play. And I was thinking, this is just a nightmare. It happens all the time. And I was literally just going to go up and just say, yes, thanks very much. Great that Yes are in. Sorry, Chris isn't here. And I was standing there, and Trevor and John, who both know about all the comedy that I do in the UK, and Trev just went, go for it. And I said, what do you mean, go? He said, go on, liven it up. I said, I can't. He said, go on. I said, look, nobody knows me over here for doing comedy. He said, good time to start, isn't it? So I stepped forward, and there was this hum from the audience of people talking, quite rightly so, around their tables. And so I just started with a few one-liners that I use sometimes in one of the stand-up shows. And suddenly it all sort of went quiet, and people went, oh, this could be interesting.
Yes.
So the hardest thing then was thinking on my feet, because I couldn't do one of the normal routines, because they are anecdotal. They're quite long. So I thought, right, I can't do that because it'll go on too long. So I'm trying to pluck things out of the different things that I use to throw in to keep it going. And it was great fun. I think I got accused by the Daily News of being irreverent or something. But I wasn't.
That's a good word, irreverent. I like that word.
But it wasn't at all. I mean, I was very proud to be part of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and to be part of it. I just can't stand acceptance speeches. I mean, Joan Baez came to me after and she said, give me a big kiss. I said, brilliant. thank you, sir. I've had Lenny Kravitz send a message through my son, who plays with Ozzy Osbourne, to say it was the best thing that's happened at the Hall of Fame for years.
He's probably right.
It wasn't meant to be irreverent. It's just that everybody who's in there knows the history of all of the bands, knows the history of the artists. So they really couldn't care less that Uncle Donald had bought them a bass guitar when they were six. They couldn't give a toss. So it's a But as I say, it's not just Rock and Roll Hall, it's for all the speeches.
Yeah.
I mean, I love watching the Oscars and I love watching the Globes and the Emmys.
Well, especially when Ricky Gervais hosts. I mean, that's fantastic.
Ricky's a good friend. He is wonderfully irreverent as well.
Yeah.
I mean, he is a wonderful, wonderful man, Ricky. I've got so much time for him.
Oh, that's great. Rick Wakeman is in the studio with us. Now, so have you always been the sort of comedic relief in the band? Like even going back to Straub's and Yes and things like that?
It goes back to then. It started at school, you know, when I was in trouble, if I hadn't done my homework, you know, rather than get the cane, I discovered quite quickly if you could make the teacher laugh, that they couldn't be angry.
Pain avoidance.
Absolutely. It was brilliant. So I learned that, you know, quite early on, and that music and telling gags and having fun covered a multitude of problems that you could get yourself into.
Do you have any lead vocalist jokes?
Lead vocalist jokes?
Yes.
Oh, crap.
And if not, lead guitar jokes or bass player jokes or drummer jokes?
Well, there's loads of drummer jokes.
Oh, let's hear one.
Oh, you know them all anyway, you know.
Maybe not.
What do you call a drummer without a girlfriend?
What?
Homeless. they're all old, but they're all.
Come
good.
On, let's hear another.
Okay, here's some banjo ones for you.
Okay.
What's the definition? I don't know whether you have the same word over here over that we're doing. What's the definition of perfect pitch?
What?
A banjo into a skip from 30 yards. And we got a... And what's the least heard expression in a recording studio?
Okay, we're done?
No, I'm sorry we're running late. The banjo player's just parking his Porsche. Oh, there's so many of them.
Please indulge us in this story, which you've told a lot. But it's an amazing story for people like us in this room and everybody watching on Facebook and listening on the radio. The story about how you came to work with David Bowie. And this was during Straub's and before Yes? Do I have that right or no?
Oh, yeah. It was before Straub's, before Yes.
Oh, before both, yeah.
Before both.
Okay. 69?
69 it was, yeah. That's the year, not what I was doing. It was 1968. I first met David. I met him at a place called, well, it was Regal Xenophone, the label, run by Denny Cordell in London. And there was Tony Visconti there and Gus Dudgeon there. And that's where I just met him, just to say hello. And what happened was I was doing a session shortly after that in 68 for a band called Junior's Eyes. Really good band. Sort of cross between quite heavy metal, before metal really existed, moving into classic sort of rock thing. It was a good band, and Tony Visconti produced them, and he booked me to go and do some organ with them. So I went down to the studio where they were, and I put a lot of Hammond organ on these tracks. And in the corner was a Mellotron, which was a double manual Mellotron. They just got it in, and I said, "Oh, when did that come?" They said, "Oh, we got it in a little while ago, but it won't stay in tune, so we don't use it."
Did they use the Mellotron on Sgt. Pepper in 67?
Yeah.
And, so very, very new.
Yeah, right? Very new. And he said, "Nobody could keep." So we can't keep it in tune. So I had a bit of a break while they were doing other stuff, and I said, "Can I have a go?" And they said, "Yeah, of course you can." And so I switched it on, and I'd never played one before. I was playing it, and basically, in a simplistic terms, it's a series of tapes of recorded notes, and when you press a note, it presses the tape against a playback head, so then it will play the note. Press two, and they both get pressed. But obviously, because of the motor, the more notes you press down, the more strain it is on the motor, so it starts to go slower, so the tuning goes all over the place. So I played around for a little bit, and I found a way of doing certain fingering that if you did it carefully, you could avoid it going out of tune. You could cheat it. And also, the notes only played for 8 seconds because that's how...
Right, yeah, it runs out.
So
yeah.
I found a way of getting around that, of doing it. And Tony Visconti came out. He said, "How'd you do that?" And I said, "Oh, so there's a crafted little way you can actually, you know, get away with it and make it." He said, "Oh, that's interesting." And it was early 1969. I was working with a 17-piece soul band About 30 miles outside of London. Great band. Fantastic. We used to do all the Otis Redding stuff and Wilson Pickett and Sam and Dave. Great band.
That's fun.
And we were having a rehearsal on Thursday afternoon. And there was a phone call down there from Gus Dudgeon. He said, look, we're in Trident Studios. He said, can you come up quick? We're recording a track with David. He wants the Mellotron on it. We've got one here, but no one can keep it in tune. He said, and Tony Visconti said, you were the only person he knew who could actually keep it in tune. He said, can you get up here? I went, yeah. So I drove up to London to Trident Studios, went in, and David was there, and it was Space Oddity. And we went down and ran through it once, and then I did it, and... it's quite funny because I think it was Herbie Flowers on bass, I think. And Herbie said, how do you keep in that in tune? And I suddenly realised, hold on a minute, I've got an advantage here over a lot of other people doing yes. sessions. And I said, can't really tell you. And Herbie said, you want more work? I said, you've got it.
Yeah.
And so that's how I came to do that. And then afterwards, David said to me, I've heard some of your piano playing. He said, would you like to do some piano stuff with me? And I said, I'd love to. So he invited me back a few days later, and I did Wild Eyed Boy from Free Cloud and Memory of a Free Festival, and a couple of other tracks and things. And then it was after that that he invited me round to his house and played on his acoustic guitar the songs that were going to be on Hunky Dory. And that's how that happened. And we just became really good. I found him so good to work with because he was so generous to musicians, unbelievably generous. I mean, with things like Life on Mars, where he said... he said, okay, when he played to me on the acoustic guitar, I said, play it on the piano. And I said, how do you want it? And he said, you know how I want it. I said, well, no, you tell me how you want it played. He said, play it. So I played it. He said, that's how I want it.
Which was how? You want to show us?
How I play. Yeah, I can play. It was very much, David was, how can I say, he always, for all of his life, he picked on musicians that he thought would understand what he was trying to do musically at the time. It was the most influential person I ever had. Here's a short version then of Life on Mars.
So beautiful. Thank you for doing that.
That's all right, sir.
And Rick Wakeman is with us. He's playing at the Paramount Theater September 24th, Bergen Pack October 10th. All the tour dates, rwcc.com. With the chords with that song, were you amazed that it was so... It is not a standard rock song by any means whatsoever. And when he played it for you on the guitar, was it like that? Or had you embellished it a little bit more with that intro?
I did a few things, like some of the bass notes of the run-up, which is other... really fitted the bass line to run up. But David, he was very clever. All of the stuff I did with him, he always, whatever you expected him to do, it did something different. So it would start off quite normally, and then he would do just something completely you didn't expect. He was really clever at that, his songwriting. He was a real craftsman at songwriting. And, of course, the great thing was his songs, the lyrics were always great. They always told stories because he came from the folk world. He was a folk singer, Davy Jones. He used to go out doing the folk clubs, how he started. So he took that wonderful attribute of being able to tell stories to the songs as he progressed into, you know, more what I call four band orchestral kind of works. It was a perfect sort of ascendancy to get to where he got.
And every album was different, right? I mean, single album.
He was just so clever. But it's interesting. If you put them all in order, you can track how he got to each bit. It
does work. Yeah.
You know, you take his first, I suppose, some of the folk albums, and then onto the David Bowie album, which has got tracks like Wild Eyed Boy from Free Code on it, which was a bit of a forerunner in a strange way to Life on Mars, because it told a story. It told a great story, and the same with Space Oddity as well. And then, of course, you move on then to Ziggy and all that. And you can actually see the pattern if you put them all together. It's a graph, and you can see where he was going. Right, I'm onto this now. But I'm taking the best of that, and I want to do this now.
With the Grumpy Old Rockstar Tour, do you get into the current situation between the two versions of Yes, or do you just kind of leave that alone?
No, I mean, I do some Yes pieces in the show,
right?
And I play some Yes pieces and tell a couple of stories, but the stories that I tell are relevant to the Yes that I'm sort of a part of, really, which is
right.
John, because John and I have done some things together. We're good friends. He's got a great sense of humour. So, and as people know, John is wonderful. He's, you know, in fact, you know, I've often said to my friends at NASA, you could save an awful lot of money. You don't need to keep sending stuff up to find out what's up there, because John can tell you. So I do quite a lot of great fun John stories, because he's such a good pal. I stick to that. I've had enough controversy in my life.
Is it amicable at least now? I mean, is it?
I don't know. I mean, I don't. I've not. Spoken to any of them for ages. I mean, but in the same way that I've got lots of friends in other bands that I don't, you know, you don't speak to,
you don't call up.
I mean, if Steve walked in here now, I'd say hello, and if he fancied a tea or something or a chat, I'd be of course very happy to do it. Yeah, no problem at all. There's no, I don't have
animosity or
no, I don't have any of that. In fact, Steve. When Steve lost his son, we were on tour. It was ARW, and we were just genuinely absolutely gutted.
Yeah,
it was just horrendous. You know, I did send him an email with no reply necessary, just saying how genuinely, because I knew Virgil very well.
Yeah.
You know, so I think it's. There's a sort of a brotherhood, and yes, I mean, there's been some ludicrous things said, which I can't be honest, I find some of them quite funny.
Yeah, yeah. Well, life is too short, right?
It is. I mean, life is too short. You're dead right. I've had a few things happen, especially in recent years, with illnesses in the family and things that have and losses that have really made me realise that the future is actually now. It's not 3 years' time or 4 years' time. So if you've got something you want to do, do it now.
My father, one day back in 1973, brought home a really cool album for me to listen to. It was The Six Wives of Henry VIII.
All right.
I wore that album out on vinyl. I had to get another copy because I loved it so much. And the solo albums after that, really, really successful. Would you play something off Six Wives for us? Anything you want. But yeah.
Yeah, I'll do you a short version of it because they're all quite long.
Yes, they are.
So I will shorten them.
Tell us about that.
Well, The Six Wives was an album. It's got quite a good story to it, really. I was signed to A&M Records with Straubs, and part of the contract with Straubs was that each individual was also signed to A&M as an option, that if you left and they wanted to take it up as an option, they would do.
Did that happen a lot back then?
It did, because a lot of bands were signing up for a record company, taking a big advance, then breaking up, and then reforming as another band, and record companies got wise and went, hold on, no, we're not having any of this.
Yeah.
So you were signed. It didn't mean to say that you would definitely get a contract, but we've been with a chance. Well, I joined Yes, and we were over in America in 1971 November, and Jerry Moss got a message.
The legend. Wow.
Oh, wonderful, absolute wonderful man. I've got nothing but great admiration for him. He sent a message to my manager, still the same manager now, Brian Lane, that he wanted to see me. So we went down to the lot where they were based. A&M were on the old
Charlie Chaplin lot on Sunset Boulevard.
Yeah, absolutely. Which that was really prophetic in a way, because I ended up living in Switzerland for 4 years in the 70s, and I lived just up the road from Charlie Chaplin, and sort of got to meet him and told him that I'd been on his lot and things. Anyway, that's by the way. So I went there, and Jerry said, I want you to do an album. And I think it was because, yes, we're just starting to get some notice, big notice in America. And he thought, well, nothing to lose, really. So I got the magnificent sum of about $12,000, which was £4,000 back then.
Make the record.
To make the record.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's really funny. He said, I'd like to buy you a little present, you know, if you, you know, for doing it. And I went, well, that's very kind. And I said, up to $1,000 if there's something that you really like. And I said, well, that's very kind. And we were staying up at the Riot House on Sunset Street.
The Riot, oh my
and
God.
Just down from there was a sort of what I call a dodgy car lot. It was a real dodgy car lot with a lot of stuff that, you know, was. But at the back of this dodgy car lot was a 1957 Cadillac limousine.
Wow.
And it was not in great condition. $995 it was.
Unbelievable.
$995. So I said to Jeff, I'd like that. And he went, really? And I said, yeah. He said, I'll send.
What color?
Black.
Yeah.
He said, I'll send someone up to have a look at it. So he sent somebody up, and the day he came back, he said, it's a heap. And I said, it's lovely. It's fantastic. So he bought it, and they shipped it back to England for me, and I had it. I lost it in the first divorce, because like the six wives of Henry VIII, I've had nearly as many as Henry had. But I went away, and I'm thinking, okay, I'll go do an album. Now, I don't sing, although I have sung on records, but I don't enjoy singing. So it's going to be an instrumental, and I was trying to find a subject to do as I was on tour. And I was at a small airport on that tour, and there was a book in one of the racks at a convenience store at the airport, which was called Private Life of Henry VIII. And I like my history, so I bought the book. Because, I mean, there were no Walkmans.
Traveling, you need some reading.
There were no Walkmans even back then, so you read, you know, or slept. So I started reading this book, and it was interesting because I started reading, there was a bit about Anne Boleyn. And whilst I'm reading about her, I had this sort of theme that came into my head, and that's interesting. And I used the napkin. I used the napkin that we'd got there, and I drew some manuscript lines and I wrote it down. And I got back to the hotel, and I started reading a bit more. And the more I read, and I came to Catherine Howard, and a simple theme came out, because she was an interesting, because she was only about 19 when he chopped her head off. I mean, well, divorce was different back then. And I wrote it down, and I thought, I've got this here. I can do Henry and his six wives.
You've got the theme.
And I went back to England, and over a period of nearly a year in between Yes tours, I recorded the six wives. And then the engineer, Paul Tregurtha, who was doing it, said, OK, we're going to do Henry now, which I was going to call Defender of the Faith, which is what the Pope called him. He said, no room, album's full. So it changed. The original title, which was going to be Henry VIII and his six wives, it became The Six Wives of Henry VIII, because I couldn't get Henry on.
So when you say full, you because of what would fit on vinyl?
What would fit on vinyl.
Which was how much then?
Excuse me, about 36, 38 minutes at best, really.
Is it more now or no?
Yeah, you can squeeze on a bit more, but not an awful lot more, but you can squeeze on a bit more. And it was interesting because it bugged me a little bit. And then in 2009, I got invited, because it was the 500th anniversary of Henry's accession to the throne. And they said, would you like to perform The Six Wives of Henry VIII at Hampton Court? Never been allowed before. You had to get the Queen's permission and everything. I said, absolutely.
Yes.
So I did it. I did it with a symphony orchestra, a choir, huge band, had a lot of fun. And what I did, I thought, this is the opportunity to put in the track that was missing. So I put in Defender of the Faith in that. And we recorded it, and and did a video, filmed it, which was great fun. There was a lot of fun in doing it. I mean, because, as I say, like Henry, I've been married 4 times. I walked, my son, Adam, who plays with Ozzy, as you know, was part of the band. And the band was in a tear, because there were so many of us. and he's looking over the top. And on that, we did two nights, and on the first night we came out, the director of the film said, "Rick, it's really important when you come out," because I walked out with six wives, six actresses dressed as the six wives. He said, "It's important when you come out that you look very straight, because even though I've got cameras a long way away, they're looking at your face. It's got to be serious because you're coming out with the six wives." I went, "Okay, fine." And we came out from the back, from the west gate, and came out. It did look good from out the front because it was a massive stage, and came out towards, walk out to the front looking all serious. And my son hangs over the top, and he went, "Dad." And I went, "Shut up." "Yeah, Dad." He said, "Which one's my mum?" And I went, and of course,
I see that it runs in the family.
Oh yeah,
obviously.
The wives and we're all sort of, the shoulders are going, we're all sort of laughing. So the director said, "Us, we'll have one more try tomorrow,
oh,
but that's the last try we've got." Went, right, okay.
You want to play us something from Six Wives?
I'll do you a little short bit of well, there's Catherine Howard, which is.
Rick Wakeman playing live for us here on Q104.3's Out of the Box. He'll be at the Paramount Theater in Huntington September 24th and Bergen Pack October 10th. All the tour dates, rwcc.com, on the Grumpy Old Rockstar Tour. So is it true that you bought a horse from the Queen Mother?
Yeah, it started...
Was it at Hampton House that you...
No. Okay. I'll try and shorten the story a little bit. When I was at the Royal College of Music, I loved the harpsichord. And the harpsichord is an interesting instrument because the keys are smaller than that of a piano.
Yes.
So it's a different technique. I wasn't a harpsichord student. I used to sneak into one of the rooms that had a harpsichord in it. And there was a particular make of harpsichord that I love, built by a guy called Thomas Gough. Best British harpsichords ever made. Fantastic. And there was one room that had a Thomas Gough in it. So I used to sneak in.
Featured prominently on Six Wives, I believe.
It did indeed.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. And I went in and would play it when there was nobody looking. And then literally one day the door opened and there's a man standing there. And he said, "You're not a harpsichord student." I went, "Oh." And no. He said, "So why are you playing this then?" I said, "Well, I like the harpsichord. It's a different technique and I want to try and learn the technique." And he said, "Okay." He said, "Why this particular harpsichord?" I said, "Because I think Thomas Gough harpsichords are the finest harpsichords made." He went, "Would you like to play one more often?" And I said, I'd love to. He said, I live not far away from here. Here's my card. Come round Friday morning." And I took the card and it was Thomas Gough.
Whoa.
And he lived in a huge house just off of Piccadilly with the butler and the whole thing. And I'm like an 18-year-old student. So I go broke. So I go round there and knock on the door. And the butler answered the door and said, "Mr. Gough is expecting you to come in." So I went in this massive house And he, Thomas Goff came out. He said, "Ah, yeah." He said, "Right." He said, "Let's go in." He said, "I've chosen a harpsichord that I think you'll really like." And went into this big room where there's about three harpsichords. And silly things, he said, "Don't mind budgerigars." And I said, "No." And there were budgerigars flying all over the place. He loved budgies. So he said, "You carry on playing and enjoy yourself." So I said, "Thank you." So I sit down, I'm playing away. And it came to about 11:30, 12:30. And the butler comes in again. And he said, "Mr. Goff would like you to take morning tea with him and his other guest in the parlour." I went, "Right, okay, parlour? I lived in a house with one room downstairs and one room upstairs with my mum and dad. Parlour, what the hell is this?" So they took me into this parlour and there was big table. The room was enormous. And there were cooks and all people about. And he said, sit down. So I sat down. And there was a woman at the end of the table reading the Sporting Life paper. And I'm sitting there, and he said, "This is the young man I told you about." And she put the paper down. It was the Queen Mother.
Wow.
And I didn't know what to do. I did stand up, curtsy.
Right,
went,
yeah, what do you do?
And I said, and she went, "Hello." And I said, "Hello." She said, "You've been playing?" I said, "Yes." She said, "Most enjoyable." I said, "Well, thank you." She said, "Do you like horses?" And I said, "Well, yeah, I quite like horses." She said, "I'll give you a tip." And I said, "I'm a student. I haven't got any money." And she went, "Well, even a shilling each way would do whatever." So she, I didn't as it happened, but we did that, which was good fun. And I went away thinking, I can't believe it. I've just had tea with the Queen Mum. We move on now to 1973. And a great friend who was a journalist in England who loved his racehorses. And he took me to a meeting one day. And I'm not a gambler at all. I don't gamble at all. But I really enjoyed it. It was just great fun for jumping. It wasn't a flat racing. And I met this trainer called John Webber. And he said, "Would you like to buy a horse?" And I said, "Why not? I've done everything else, rock and roll, and yeah, I'll have a horse. And that would be good fun."
Cadillac hearse, that's or it. Cadillac limo,
that's
horse.
It. And horse, yeah. It just makes sense, doesn't it? So he said, "There's a very good gelding for sale." And it was a year-old gelding. It was £8,000, which is quite a lot of money in 1973.
Yes,
for a jump. And he said, "It's a very good." He said, "It's owned by the Queen Mother." I went, "Oh, okay." I said, "I've met her." He said, "Have you?" I said, "Yeah, many years ago when I was a student." He said, "All right." So we had to go down to Wiltshire in the West Country to where this horse was. And we arrived there, and the trainer, who was one of her trainers who was looking after it, came out and met me and met our vet and all that kind of thing. And I mean, I had hair down my back. I was out and up like a roller then. And he said, "It's interesting." He said, "The Queen Mother is in residence at the moment. She's down, and she wants to come out and see the new owner of the gelding." And I said, "Oh," he said, have you got a name for it yet?" I said, "Yeah, we're going to call it Tropical Saint because of its heritage, where it came from, the different names." He said, "Oh, okay, that's nice." So the Queen Mother came out. We all have to line up. So there's all the stable boys, me and the other people. And she comes trotting down the line, bless her. And she gets to me, and she had a wicked sense of humour. And he said, this is Mr. Rick Wakeman who's bought the gelding." And she went, "Yeah, lovely." And he said, "Apparently you've met." And she said, "Oh, have we?" And I said, "Yes, ma'am." I said, at Thomas Goff's house. She said, "Yes." I said, "I was playing the harpsichord." She went, "Oh, yes." I said, "And you were reading the Sporting Life and I came and had a..." She said, "Yes." And she went, "Fascinating." And just walked on. And I felt absolutely deflated. And she spoke to a couple more people. Then she came back down the line. She said, "I remember it really well. Of course I do." She said, "Thomas," he said, is like a third cousin. He said, "He's..." And she said, "You played lovely. You still playing?" I said, "Yeah." And she said, "And John Webber's having the horse?" I said, "Yeah." But she was great. I mean, she managed to make me feel about that small, and then
elevated you once again,
and then inflate me again. You know,
I'm going to hold up an album here that everyone recognizes. It's Close to the Edge. What I want to know is when Yes is on Atlantic back in the day.
Yeah.
And you finish this album, and you hand it in to I don't know who your guy was. I know it was Ahmet Erdogan. Eventually,
Ahmet always had the
was
final
Was he
say.
Like, wait a second, one song is 18 minutes long. Where is the 4-minute single for Top 40 Radio?
Armour was, there were a few great heads of companies back then, and Armour Ertegun and of course his brother Nesui, were of that ilk, that they signed musicians and bands and artists to do what they did best. They signed them because of what they did. They didn't sign them to get them and say, this is what you're going to do. And that was why Armour, and that's why the company, Atlantic and WO, was so successful. It's why A&M was so successful. Because when you look at the roster that, for example, A&M had with sort of people like me, I took them the Tubes. I signed the Tubes to
you
A&M.
Did? Really?
Yeah. I mean, and you had the Carpenters. You know, you had...
They were modestly successful, huh?
Yeah, you had Supertramp.
Yeah.
So many different kinds of music. Because Jerry Moss was clever enough to go, I sign these people because they're good at what they do. And, you know, I don't have to understand everything they do. But why am I going to tell them what to do? And that's why Armour was so successful. So when Atlantic were given the Close to the Edge album after Fragile, it was not, oh, we're going to have a listen to it and tell you if we like it. It was always, great, let's find out the best way that we can get this out to the people. And that's how the record companies worked back then, or the good ones did, yeah.
Rick Wakeman is with us. I have to tell you, first of all, I want to thank you because I know Roundabout was the band's biggest hit, and it was actually the first song that I learned on guitar.
You know,
the intro. I didn't learn the rest of it, mind you. But I want to thank you for that song because I love the whole song. But my favorite part of that song is your organ solo. And I'll tell you why, because that organ solo got me really into you and what you were doing and all of your keyboards. But it also got me into Keith Emerson. It got me into Steve Winwood. It got me into the Hammond B3. So much that I was like Jimmy Smith and Jack McDuff.
Yeah.
You know those guys too. So I just want to thank you for Roundabout it. And it was a distorted sort of organ sound, right? I mean, it wasn't your typical...
No, we all of us went for different kind of sounds. Keith had his own unique sound that he had on the Hammond. So did John Lord. John Lord had a little box
Deep Purple,
of tricks.
Yeah.
He had a box of tricks where he put the organ through it.
Hush is one of my...
Hush was brilliant. John was one of my dearest friends. I did the eulogy, sadly, at his funeral, which was tough because John and I were in the process of starting an album together.
Oh.
And he died, you know, before we even got going, which was terrifying. We wrote one song, which is recorded. It exists. But John wanted to find his own unique way. So he got this little box of tricks that he used to do along with the Leslie and the speakers and things, and got a very unique thing. I mean, he did things with the Leslies and organs that nobody else was really doing at the time. In 1968, the album Shades of Deep Purple, which was the first Deep Purple album in before Roger Glover, that was when Nick Simper and Rod Evans were in the band, and when they did Hush, of course. And they did a version of Help, the Beatles' Help on there.
Oh, yeah?
That is fantastic. For 1968, it is way ahead of its time. And a lot of that's down to John and the sounds and things that he did. It was really important for a lot of us to have a sound that was recognisable to us, that's your organ sound or your synth sound or your style of playing. And I did use Leslie's, but mostly I put stuff through guitar 4x12 cabinets.
Right, yeah,
and
yeah.
I put them through there and got them up to the point of distortion flying out the... You know, flying out of the cabinets.
How do the Beatles come into play in your show for the Grumpy Old Rockstars tour? How do you?
Well, the Grumpy Old Rockstars show, as I say, is me on the piano playing lots of music I've been involved with, plus stories.
Yes.
And I've recorded quite a lot of Beatles stuff because they wrote just phenomenal phenomenal melodies. And the thing is, if you're going to do variations on music, you've got to have a strong melody. If you've got a strong melody, you can do an awful lot with that and do it in so many different styles, which is why they've been covered by so many people. And I had the pleasure of meeting... Well, I had a sort of a strange lunch with John Lennon shortly before he was murdered here in New York. I was having lunch at Tavern on the Green.
Right down the street from their place.
Down the street.
Right,
yeah. Well, still my favourite place to go and have lunch in the Crystal Room. Love it to bits. And I was in there, and at the next table was John. It was John and Yoko was sitting there. Never met him before, didn't know him. And I thought, should I go and say hello? I thought, no, he won't have a clue why I'm not going to say hello. And he got up and came and sat at the table. And
1980,
he,
right?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. And he said, yes, do you over? And I said, well, there's talk of a tour, but we've been in the middle of an album and it's all gone sort of horribly wrong in Paris. He said, tell me about it, because he was getting so much grief on the album he was doing.
Double Fantasy.
And which was a shame, because you know, leave the guy alone. Great writer, great thing, and we chatted for quite a long time, and about music and things, and I liked him a lot, and we said, oh look, we'll get together at some time. And of course we had an association as well because of Alan White, because Alan had worked with John a lot.
Yeah.
And I was living in Switzerland at the time, and I got back to Switzerland. By the time I got back, he'd been shot.
That's crazy.
Which was and George, I spent 4 hours with discussing music and spiritual parts of music,
right,
in Cannes in France. Shortly before he passed away. And I loved his melodies, and I loved Paul's melodies and John's melodies, because if you've got a great melody, you can play around with them. Composers have been doing it for years. They would take, Haydn would do it to Mozart stuff. Oh, I'll take that and I'll play it in a different way. And if you've got a good melody, you can do that. And there are no better writers than John, Paul and George. No offence, Ringo, but Octopus's Garden's not one that I really want to do, but that's my association with them.
Tell us about you have a very successful series called Portraits, which you've been doing, and you have a new one coming out called Christmas Portraits.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
tell us about that.
Well, that came about a lot. I mentioned before how what an influence in my life David Bowie has been, in so many respects. I learned so much from him in the studio, performing and wise. And when he passed away, I was asked to do a eulogy on BBC Radio, which I did, which was hard. I've got to admit, it was really tough to do, taking lots of calls. And I played Life on Mars live, and they webcammed it. And a couple of days later, the Simon Mayo, who was the presenter, the DJ, called me up and said, we've had nearly 3 million hits on the webcam. I went, joking. And he said, really? He said, people are saying you should release it and put it out. I said, I'm not going to release it out for profit. I'm certainly not going to do that at all. And a good friend of mine said, do it as a charity record. I said, I hate charity records. There are warehouses and places full of charity records. You know, I don't like charity records at all. And he said, well, I think in this situation, it would be good to do. And I spoke to my lovely wife, Rachel, and I said, because she knew about it, and I said, come on, Rachel, what do you think? And she said, I think, first of all, you should think to yourself, if David were alive, because you were great friends, what would he say? And I said, well, probably for a good cause, like a cancer charity, he'd probably say, yeah, go for it. She said, well, do it then. So I did it, and we did it for a cancer charity, all the profits to a cancer charity in England. Did very well. The single was number one for about 8 weeks in England. It did really, really well. And then, of course, I had people on me saying, why don't you do a whole album of piano stuff? And thinking, oh, really? And yeah, come on, of music that you like, of music you've been involved with over the years and whatever. So I said, well, piano albums won't sell. And they said, do it. So Universal came to me and said, come on. So again, my wife said, you should do it. So I recorded Piano Portraits and put tracks on it like Morning Has Broken, which I did the original of, and put Space Oddity on and a few other tracks. And to my stunned amazement, it sort of shot into the top five in England, which no piano album had ever done.
Right, it was the first time, right?
I mean, first time ever. And it was, because one of the difficult things, of course, in the UK, on radio, they will not play instrumental tracks. So I couldn't get any airplay. I got airplay on some of the classical stations, funny enough, but not on any of the mainstream stations. And it stayed for about 11 weeks in the top 10. I did some tours to go with it, and it was really successful. And then Sony came on to me and said, we'd like you to do a Christmas one. Christmas portraits. And I said, well, it's too soon after piano portraits. And they said, well, do something in intermediary, whatever. So I did an album called Piano Odyssey, which was came in the middle again, which was a top 10 album. And this time I just added a few strings, a string section and a bit of choir here and there, which was great fun to do, just to make it that little bit different. And there was an interesting thing in there because one of the tracks I wanted to do was Bohemian Rhapsody as an instrumental, because Brian May is one of my closest friends and I wanted to do that. So I tried to do it for piano portrait, but I couldn't get it to work. And I went back to it and looked at it. I went, I know why it won't work, because it does need those little additives, like a little choir coming in here and there and a little bit of strings coming in here and there. So I did it, and we finished it in the studio. And Toby, my engineer there, he said, this sounds really good. He said, has Brian heard this? I went, ah, no. He said, does he know you're doing it? I went, no. He said, well, I know he's a really close friend of yours. I said, he is. I said, I also know that he hates so many versions that have been done of Bohemian Rhapsody. I'm afraid that he just really hates some of the ones. And I went, ah, you're right. So I said, look, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I said, we'll send it to Brian as it is now, just a board mix of it is. And if he hates it, we'll take it off the album, because I'm not going to spoil a friendship. It's too, we'll do something else and put it on it. So he sent it to Brian. I did phone him up first. I said, Brian, I'm sending you something. He said, oh, great, what's that? And I said, I'm sending you a piano version of Bohemian Rhapsody. And he went very quiet. He went, really? And I said, yeah, I know how important that piece is to you, and especially to Freddie and everything as well. I said, so look, I'm going to send it to you. And if you don't like it, I won't put it on the album. He said, well, I can't stop you doing that. I said, you can, because my friendship's more important than the actual track. So I sent it to him, and he came back very quickly and said, right. He said, I love it. He said, I absolutely love it. He said, Freddie would have adored this. And I said, oh, that's really kind. He said, it's just one little thing. And I said, what's that? He said, well, right towards the end, he said, well, you do almost, you turn the big guitar thing into like a Spanish thing. I said, yeah. He said, it could really do with a tiny little bit of flamenco guitar. So I said, hold on a minute, we'll find it on the, so we found it on the track plan. And I said, do you know what? You're spot on right. I'll get somebody to do it. He said, no, you won't. Send it to me. I'll do it.
Oh,
he said,
man.
He said, nobody else is doing that. So I sent it to him, and he put this little cameo flamenco guitar on it, which was absolutely sensational.
And what album is that on?
Excuse me, that's on Piano Odyssey.
That's the last one, and then you got the Christmas Portraits coming out.
Yeah, the Christmas
in November.
Portraits, which we've finished. That comes out November the 29th, and it's got 22 really well-known Christmas songs, which I do as piano pieces, lots of variations on them. You will recognise all of the songs, but you've got no chance if you want to sing along. Not a hope.
Give us a minute or so of one.
Oh, crikey, I wish you wouldn't, because honestly, I can't, at this present moment in time, I couldn't really tell you exactly half the things that I did. This is Christmas, though. Christmas.
Everybody, don't freak out. You don't have to buy any presents just now. It is still September.
But I mean, you think about buying me presents.
Oh, yeah. Well, Rick Wakeman, man, so good to have you in the studio with us. Grumpy Old Rockstar Tour coming to Paramount Theater in Huntington September 24th, Bergen Pack October 10th. All the tour dates, rwcc.com. A real honor to have you in the studio.
No, Joe, it's a great pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot.
This is Out of the Box with your host, Jonathan Clark. Out of the Box, Sunday nights at 9 on Q104.3.